So today we have Professor Landini from University of Pisa. He is the president of Biomedical Engineering degree program in Pisa, who, as I told you a couple of days ago, includes bachelor degree, master degree, and the degree in bionics engineering. So welcome, Professor.
Okay, thank you. It's a pleasure for me to to be invited here to bring my experience that is in medical imaging. I've been asked to talk about advanced medical imaging, so this this means that I deal with main high tech, and because the dealing is very wide, I will try to concentrate in half an hour, in order, assuming that somebody knows what are the basics of this technology, so in order to give you some spot of what is now the research at the level of big industry that are involved in this production. Brief history. You know that we started the medical application in 1896 with discovery of X-ray techniques, and with this some very simple application like the one that you see in this these slides. But immediately after, since 1920, there was a big improvement in this technology. So the community like to call this imaging 1.0, because since 1920, physicians started to understand the importance of this new invention, and try for 40, 50 years to adapt this technology to the medical care. But the really increase of technology is dated 1970, when from them starting to develop a really important technology modality, the cold modality, and mainly contrast agents that are the means that allow images to gain a lot of performance in terms of clinical application. Since 1990, a coincidence of development of new modality with development of PACS, picture archival communication systems, and knowledge-based systems, there was the explosion of this technology. Here, there is a slide with the main dates. You see here, computerized tomography in 1972, magnetic resonance 1989, after ultrasound with contrast medium, and in the last century, integrated or hybrid technologies. Why we talk about multimodality? We talk about multimodality imaging because physician to perform diagnosis need many information that usually are not available with only one methodology. You see, for instance, that physician need to know anatomy or structure information, but you need also physiology, behavior, but mainly metabolism and the molecular. So this is the motive because I put this one, because somebody of this high-tech imaging mainly are involved in anatomy or structural information, like computerized ultrasound and magnetic resonance. While when we talk about metabolism or molecular imaging, we have to, you need move to another techniques that is the nuclear medicine techniques. So multimodality imaging is what the physician use currently to perform diagnosis. Now I will start with the four methodologies that are most important, that are computerized tomography, magnetic resonance, ultrasound, and nuclear medicine, in order to put some flash of what is a brief history of this one, and what is most important, the hot topics in this new in these disciplines. Evolution starts from X-ray, that is a planar images, because there is a projection images like the one, there is a transmitter and a receiver, this one, to introduce what perform the real improvement of technology in the diagnosis since 1972, when computerized tomography has been invented, and that put a strong revolution in the medicine, because it was the first time that you can use 3D data volumes, a difference of this one that was planar images. The innovation of the last two decades contemplates a scanner like this one, where there is a transmitter, a receiver with a rotating tube. So the projection are performed by moving mechanically this one, while the gantry, the patient table, is moved continuously. So in this way there's, you obtain what you call 3D images. But the real improvement has been made with electron beam tomography, where there is no mechanical part in movement, but an electronic beam that rotate under electronic processing, in order to stimulate the emission of X-ray, and so in this way you have no movement, mechanical movement, but you have only electronic beam movement. So in this way you improve strongly the speed of acquisition with respect to mechanical. We have really 3D dimensional images, and what is important is most important that we improve the resolution mainly in the slice direction. Last generation of computerized scanner is this one, where the technology is moving toward the development of a multi-array detector, in order to obtain in a single rotation a complete images. This was the benefit that actually we are able to obtain in a single shot a the image, the volumetric image of the heart, so in a very, very short time. So this is the last evolution of this technology. Another evolution that we have now is the detector technology. Conventionally, you have to know that X-ray, that is high energy, is transformed with the scintillator in a bandwidth that is a visible bandwidth, and there is a photodiode that converts the light into current. So there is a substrate to transform this current in electrical signal. This is the past technology. Nowadays, there is the solid state technology, where there is two steps only, one scintillator layer, and the photodiode that directly converts the light into electrical current. So there is a two-step acquisition instead of three-step acquisition. And the next generation that is just now in the research laboratory, with the photon counting detector, you can convert directly the X-ray into electrical signal. And this is the really improvement in terms of quality of images. So you have an increase, a reduction signal to noise, so you have an increase in the quality of the image, and what is important, this can produce a reduction of the dose of the radiation. About data reconstruction, as you know, in order to reconstruct an image, you have to measure a lot of profile, attenuation profile, and using a back projection algorithm, conventionally, you obtain the image from projection. The last generation of data reconstruction is based on model-based interactive reconstruction. That is a reconstruction that is performed by steps, and in this iterative reconstruction, you can put inside also models of image formation. And what is important, models of the noise. So this iterative reconstruction is able to produce high quality images because reduce the noise in terms of the signal. And also this produce better image contrast and further dose reduction. The last improvement is in the software algorithm, and in particular the rendering techniques, volumetric and the surface renderings. At this purpose, there is a lot of software available. Most of these are free software that you can find directly on the web, in order to deal with images and to perform a lot of rendering application. Here there is an example of a four-dimensional gated computerized tomography. So you have the ventricular, left ventricle, atrial, and the vessel that are reconstructed in very short time, and with this rendering technique that are reconstructed and available for any use or post-processing necessary to improve the diagnosis. For what concerns the second imaging modality, that is nuclear medicine, the history means that the discovery was about the same period of X-ray in 1896 about, but the real application were available only in the late 1972, where the development of the scanner allowed to really revolution, put a revolution into the clinics. The nuclear, the particle that we used and the energy that we used are essentially two. This is a gamma ray that is a photon, and this is a beta particle that used in positron emitter tomography. Here there is the evolution in nuclear medicine. We started with the 2D planar scintigraphy that is a single head scanner, where the tracer that being injected into the patient pass through this detector and produce an images all over the a planar images. But the evolution in this methodology is constituted by what we call the SPECTO, single photon emission computer tomography, where two heads are moved together in order to perform a projection around the patient of a tracer in order to obtain a three-dimensional data. And the most important and the last one is constituted by positron emission tomography that used beta particle to produce X gamma, cioè gamma ray, and with this tomograph, we are able to obtain images that can different from that one because can exploit the cyclotron to produce the tracer, And in this way, you can produce a lot of tracer that can be adapted to any requirement, also in terms of the research. So the PET is mainly used in terms of research nowadays. But the last evolution of tomography is constituted by this new technology that is called hybrid technologies, that is the combination of CT and the PET. And the motive of this combination is that we have together on the same scanner both functional information that has been derived from PET and anatomical information that has been derived from CT scanner. So, during the same acquisition, you can have contemporary on the same patient morphological information with high spatial resolution, with functional information or metabolic information. This is represented by an evolution of the tracer inside the lesion, and combined together to have spatial and metabolic information together. Also in this discipline, we have new evolution in terms of detection technology. In this slide, you can observe the representation with conversion of gamma rays that is like the one, is similar to the one that we have seen for computerized tomography, where the gamma ray pass through scintillation crystal, and after they are transferred to light, to luminescence, and transform from a photomultiplier tube in analog signal. This is the conventional technology. The last technology available on the market is the digital photo counting, where the photomultiplier that in the conventional one are like this one becomes like this one. So we pass from the analog photomultiplier to digital photo counting, where the resolution is one-to-one with the crystal resolution. So in this way, we have a strong improvement of resolution that we can see in these slides, where the resolution pass from this situation to this situation in terms of spatial resolution. Expected progress in PET application are this one. From one side, we have the improvement of a number of crystals around the patient in order to have the whole body in a single shot from one side. And from the other side, the industry are going toward dedicated instrumentation. So instrumentation that are very lower costs because are much smaller and can be used in single organ, dedicated organ. In this case, the costs are very low with respect to the classical tomography that you have seen before. Another modality is magnetic resonance. Magnetic resonance is relatively younger, the scanner, magnetic resonance use radio frequency signals, you know, and the scanner typically is realized with three types of magnetic field: a static magnetic field, one, gradient coil, and radio frequency coil. All together are necessary to realize the image. So we start to understand why we have a static magnetic field. Static magnetic field that typically is 1.5 to 3 Tesla is used mainly to produce a representation. These are the magnetic magnetic dipole representation of the hydrogen distribution on the body, that without magnetic field is a random distributed. When you put this inside a magnetic field, you orientate this one in order to have a net magnetization that is different from the magnet in one side with respect to the other one. This net magnetization is the one that you use to perform the images. Here we have an animation of what you have seen, where you see the definition of Larmor frequency. That means that the rotation of this magnetics field is directly related to the intensity of a static magnetic field. So the Larmor frequency is directly related to the intensity of the magnetic field. What is the Larmor frequency? The Larmor frequency is the frequency that used when we put the radio frequency inside the scanner in order to produce the images. What is the application of this one? The radio frequency pulse. The radio frequency pulse energized the magnetization that move the direction from the direction directly orientated along the static magnetic field to a different plane. And during rotation, a coil, dedicated coil, is able to measure modification of induction, magnetic induction, and this is on the basis of the signal that you use to perform the images. The third one is gradient field. What is the gradient field? The gradient field is composed of coils, three coils, one X, Y, Z coils, that are used to codify the position of emission inside the body. So the gradient is used to select the point where the scanner where the source is emitted, and using a magnetic resonance frequency, we arrived to reconstruct the key space that is the space of the key domain, that is Fourier domains, and using Fourier transform that you use to obtain the images. So, which are the major vendors of this scanner? We are Philips, General Electric, and Siemens. These are the main. And these are the typical scanner that we have, that you used. This is a closed magnetic resonance. There is an open type. And there are other type of magnet that are this one, where you can stay up, down, in order to stress some function that can be used during acquisition. The recent technology development is parallel imaging and compressed cells. Parallel imaging means that we can use more coil contemporarily in order to acquire the images. Here we have an example where you put four coil, each coil is positioned on the body, and see one part of the body, and together produce the final image. This is parallel images, produce an improvement of the quality of the images, and at the same time a better signal to noise. Compressed sense is another technique that used in scanners. It means that instead of reconstruct the images using the typical sampling theorem based on Nyquist theorem, they use undersample acquisition. So in this way they speed the acquisition, and the undersample signals is reconstructed by using not conventional k-space transform, but using some estimation techniques. So in this way, the aim of these techniques is to obtain the same quality of images, but improving strongly the acquisition speed. And so in this way you can perform some important important result like this one, where you have contemporarily acquired structural and functional information dynamically. Application like conventional application in magnetic resonance are functional magnetic resonance. Here an example of what means functional magnetic resonance, that is a structural images or anatomical images, and contemporary to this one you perform functional magnetic resonance. That means the measurement of oxygen, the oxygen contribute due to activation of neural sites. In this way, you have seen what happens when a patient observe an object that is an object without particular interest. So the vision area that is represented by the color is illuminated, but when there is some that is more particular, like this one, snake, you have the possibility, you see that amygdala, that is the first organ that is stimulated. And this is what it is possible to have with a functional magnetic resonance. Spectroscopy is another possibility of magnetic resonance, where for each voxel is possible to understand, to measure the peak of the spectrum of hydrogen, and from the intensity of the peaks you are able to measure the presence of metabolite. This is a single voxel multispectral display, while this one is single frequency multivoxel display, where the spectrum at a fixed frequency becomes an image. And this is a technique that improve, pass from structural information to something that is related to metabolic information. Also in this field there is an hybrid technology that is a combination of PET and magnetic resonance. And in this case, magnetic resonance is instead of computerized tomography, and in order to produce the same morphological information, all morphological information like the computerized tomography, but with a strong reduction of radiation that usually is present in computerized tomography. So hybrid technology is important perché can join high resolution images like magnetic resonance with sensitivity PET images, let's say metabolic information. In this case you have from one side an accurate spatial registration, from the other side with color we have metabolic information overimposed. Which is the perspective in magnetic resonance? Perspective, mainly perspective is toward high field magnetic resonance MRI. As you see from these slides, you pass from 1.5 to Tesla to 3 Tesla that becomes clinical at clinical use, to 7 Tesla that now is still at research level, but briefly this could becomes a clinical scanner. So what we expect that improvement in magnetic resonance is toward high field. Why high field? Because with high field you have a better spatial resolution like this one, with respect to this one, and also here we have an improvement on quality of the images in this application, this Faber tractography, with respect to lower magnetic field. And the last one is ultrasound. Ultrasound is has a more recent history. This is the evolution from the first experiment that in the glass water, to bistable representation, to grayscale and the color, and finally to the small computer instrumentation. The principle of image formation, you know, is based on the reflection of a signal due to impedance discontinuity among tissue. And we have the schematically represented which are the main parts of a scanner. We have a transmission, we have a reception, and we have a beamforming. Beamforming is an important part that we see before, that we see now, and is the heart of the modern instrumentation. Transducer technology is the research is toward a miniaturization. Then most of the work is based on improvement the technology in order to reduce the crystal dimension, but in order to maintain high sensitivity, you pass from array transducer to matrix transducer that used to perform three-dimensional acquisition. Here there are typical transducer to the imagings and three-dimensional imaging transducers. These are other transducers, endocavitary transducers and transesophageal transducer. Beamforming. Beamforming is the heart of the scanner and is responsible of the scanning of the patient in order to realize an image, and also is responsible of focalization of the beam, that is the base in order to obtain high quality images. Beamforming means an electronic excitation of the crystal with a particular law of excitation law, in order to produce a focused or a steering transducer in order to obtain high focalization and high spanning and of the organs. Focusing means that the transducer is excited with a particular law that produces very concentrated field in a focal point. This is an example of focalization that reduces the beam in order to improve the resolution. Phased array, beam steering means that you use a particular law in order to steer this this array in order to obtain a spanning of the horizons. Beamforming is important also because technologies toward the parallel beamforming, that means that not one line for time but multi-line for time in order to improve the speed of acquisition and spatial resolution. Here is an example of 4D art. You see these are the images that you are able to obtain now with actual technology with a very high scanning rate that can be seen from the degree of temporal resolution that you have to reconstruct the valvular movement, like this one. There is another example of four-dimensional ultrasound. And the last one is the Doppler. Doppler imaging is a combination of anatomical information with velocity information. And here the technologies grow very, very strongly in order to have images like this one, that is the brain vasculature obtained with a high frequency ultrasound transducer. Which is the future of ultrasound? Ultrasound is a technique that can be found at different level of price, from low price to high price. So it's a technique that is it is more diffuse in the hospital, because any hospital can have an instrument like this one. What is the challenge of ultrasound technology is that it remains operator dependent. So to conclude, which is the evolution of imaging technology. The evolution of imaging technology is from one side the technology evolution that you have seen since now, but the other one is the combination of all data that are available on the on a patient, that are not only the medical images, but are genomic analysis, biomarkers, information about the history of the patient, and combined together in terms of the use of information, new information technology like machine learning, in order to improve the diagnosis and in order to make less operator dependent these techniques. Thank you very much.
Hello, and thanks for your presentation. I would like to ask, how is it possible to integrate this technology with surgery ones to have like virtual or augmented reality, better, augmented reality technology that can combine imaging information during a surgery operation?
The integration? Integration is possible, but in terms of a combination of different modalities that available in a surgical site, and after using software in order to produce what we call the image fusion, that is the first step. When we present hybrid technology, I have hardware fusion of images, but there is also the software fusion of images, so you can combine the ultrasound with computerized tomography, for instance, on the same display, and to integrate this also with the real world, like what the physician see during intervention. But this is passed through high technology combined with high software solutions.
Thank you for your good presentation. I saw all the beautiful work you did, machine learning and artificial intelligence, and all the good technologies. But I have a question. When you are doing a CT scan, you use a contrast. So now the contrast is not really safe because it can cause kidney failure. And acute kidney failure is the third cause of renal failure in patients. It's significant. So are you developing any technologies to circumvent the use of this not so safe contrast?
In fact, the problem of ionizing energy is a big problem. If you see the industry try to reduce the dose by improving the sensitivity of the crystals. So a great involvement of industry is to work to produce new crystals that directly transform the high energy, gamma energy or X-ray energy into signal. And this reduces the noise, so it improves the contrast. And if you improve the contrast, you can reduce the dose. So one line of research is sure this. Other possibilities are to find new alternative technologies like ultrasound. But ultrasound is still operator dependent. And ultrasound has not a standard reference because this depends on the ability of the operator. While scanner like computerized tomography, magnetic resonance, nuclear medicine, you put a patient inside and you have the plane of acquisition plane. So you can combine this plane with the plane of another scanner together in order to combine, for instance, morphological and functional or metabolic information together. So this is a big problem. But the industry go toward the reduction of the dose in order to obtain the same quality of images.
Okay, thank you for the nice presentation. So my question is, I have two questions. The first one is concerning the compressed MRI, where they do undersampling. Okay. So because my worry there is the problem of aliasing. Is it not affecting the image in such a way that we lose some details, some anatomical details? I mean, is it not disadvantageous to do that kind of, compressed MRI imaging? And the second thing is, the diagram you showed about the evolution of the MRI, like the high field, okay? So it has been increasing, but I don't know, did you come across any a literature that talks about the maybe any harmful effect or any risk that might be caused with this high B0 field?
Okay, the first one, compressed senses, is a very sophisticated acquisition technique, so that is an alternative to Nyquist theorem. That means that with the Nyquist theorem, you have to sampling a moving structure at the frequency at least two times the frequency of the movements. So in this way, you have to, in this way you acquire all information okay, you have no problem. But you reduce the acquisition time, the acquisition speed, because the scan you have to prepare another step and so on, and the time that you need to perform a single frame is such that the heart cannot be acquired in a single shot. Use compressed sensing means that you undersample your acquisition. But if you undersample with regularly, you cannot reconstruct. If you undersample in a random way, you can reconstruct using classical estimation techniques. So the goal is to reduce, you see, at 8 times, for instance, you reduce the sampling 8 times, but not using regular undersampling. You have to use irregular undersamples. And this, in this way, you fit with classical reconstruction techniques of a signal in terms of signal in with the noise. But there is a limit on the maximum compression. Within such limits, this is a commercially available product. So if you buy a scanner now, you have the undersampling techniques in play. So this means that a physician accept this information as useful information. The second is high field. The problem, the high field, it's what means high field for the patients. The evidence are that there is no problem for the patients. So this is why the FDA, for instance, approve the use of our higher scanner, higher field scanner, because the literature has demonstrated that there is no problem for the heart. So this is the state of the heart, which is the maximum, the top where we arrive is not clear at the moment. But surely I know that just in this month in the United States has been approved for clinical application in 7 Tesla scanner. So this means that this is possible without a hazard, I hope, for the patients. And obviously, increasing the field means increasing the cost. So this is not the best solution for the market, for instance. But this purpose, I would like to, my impression is that at the moment, in medical imaging, technology has reached a very high level of sophistication. So, and the market, Occidental markets, European markets, United States markets, is full of device. So there is no new possibility. My impression is that a development for the future could be to produce smaller tomograph, dedicated tomography, with very low cost with respect to this one, in order to open new markets, because the technology is mature, the technology is very at high level. What is the problem is that at this high level technology there is a high cost of this scanner. But industry have to open new market, and in my opinion, to open new market they have to reduce the cost by reducing the scanner, quindi making some scanner, not a high field, but a scanner with a 0.2, 0.5 field, as somebody used in the knee, for instance, in some application, because the quality of the image is good, in order to open a new market.